The Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, verse 13. Verse 13. The Gospel of Luke. 24:13. Now behold, two of them were traveling that same day to a village called Emmaus, which was 7 miles from Jerusalem. And they talked together of all these things which had happened. So it was, while they conversed and reasoned, that Jesus himself drew near and went with them. But their eyes were restrained, so they did not know him. And he said to them, What kind of conversation is this that you have with one another as you walk and are sad? Then the one, whose name was Cleopas, answered and said to him, Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem? And have you not known the things which happened there in these days? And he said to them, What things? So they said to him, The things concerning Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we were hoping that it was he who was going to redeem Israel. Indeed, besides all this, today is the third day since these things have happened. Yes, and certain women of our company who arrived at the tomb early astonished us when they did not find his body. They came saying that they had also seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. And certain of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the woman had said, but him they did not see. Then he said to them, O foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe in all that the prophets have spoken. Ought not the Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. Then they drew near to the village where they were going, and he indicated that he would have gone farther. But they constrained him, saying, Abide with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is far spent. And he went in to stay with them. And it came to pass, as he sat at the table with them, that he took bread, blessed, and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they knew him, and he vanished from their sight. And they said to one another, Did not our heart burn within us while he talked with us on the road, and while he opened the scriptures to us? So they rose up that very hour, and returned to Jerusalem, and found the 11, and those who were with them, gathered together, saying, The Lord is risen indeed, and has appeared to Simon. And they told about the things that they had happened on the road, and how he was known to them in the breaking of bread. And as they said these things, Jesus himself stood in the midst of them, and said to them, Peace to you. But they were terrified and frightened, and supposed they had seen a spirit. And he said to them, Why are you troubled, and why do doubts arise in your hearts? Behold my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Handle me and see, for a spirit does not have flesh and bones as you see I have. When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. But while they still did not believe for joy and marveled, he said to them, Have you any food here? So they gave him a piece of a broiled fish and some honeycomb. And he took it and ate in their presence. Then he said to them, These are the words which I spoke to you while I was still with you, that all things must be fulfilled which were written in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms concerning me. And he opened their understanding that they might comprehend the scriptures. Then he said to them, Thus it is written, and thus it was necessary for the Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day. And that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And you are witnesses of these things. Behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you. But tarry in the city of Jerusalem until you are endued with power from on high. Amen. Two disciples with Christ from the beginning, but in which God had not opened. their minds so they can understand the scriptures. Because they weren't reborn. Because they hadn't believed in the resurrection of Jesus, which had taken place already. But even though Christ was risen according to the scriptures, even though Jesus Christ was truly with a new body, truly, all what was written was fulfilled, they did not believe. To no man, because some women had visited them and said to them that Jesus Christ is alive. And others said that we saw Christ risen. But any man who would had informed them about the kingdom of heaven, no man would have believed, because the word of man has no power. And when once a rich man was being tortured in the place of torment, he asked from Abraham, who was holding in his arms Lazarus, the poor man, and he said to Abraham, send him so he can put some water on my lips, because I'm burning in this place of torment. Abraham said, if they don't believe to Moses and the prophets, even if someone is resurrected and goes and talks to them, they won't believe either, my brethren. This is very, very crucial what the word of God is saying to us today. Your word has no power or authority. My word has nothing to offer. Don't think that you'll go and you say things will and someone might be saved. That won't happen. And if you say, I will go and speak to him, this has happened to me, that's why I'm saying this. God sees pride in our hearts. With the result, what you will say will be nonsense. Not only you won't have good results, but they'll also laugh at you. They will be laughing. Salvation only comes to man through Jesus Christ, who is the Word of God. It cannot come any other way. You cannot know the power of God, but only through the gospel of Jesus Christ. You cannot receive a thing from human counsel, advice, opinion. You can't even offer a thing. You want to offer something? Go to the Word of God and pray about it. Believe in the Word of God. And people told them, and they heard about angels, they heard about everything, but nothing. They were disappointed. We hoped that he would free Israel. He was the one to free us. That's what we hoped in, but we were disappointed. And this is very serious and important, my beloved brethren, for us to know that we can never offer comfort. And I will say this, do you want me to comfort you? I'm the only one who can't. We cannot offer comfort, nor strength, nothing. Nor any other person can offer these things to us. Whatever you or I try to do, we'll end up being disappointed and in despair. Because we are humans, blind. If a blind man leads a blind man, they'll both fall into a pit. And we must take off us every thought that we can do something. Take it off us, condemn it, we can't. And we even lose God's favor in our lives if we think we can substitute Jesus Christ. We lose God's favor if we think that any man can substitute the work of Jesus Christ in our lives. Don't hope, don't believe, nor in yourself, nor in any other person. It is given, sure, and completely assured that you will create desperation in your life. And disappointment will be created in you. We must wake up, brethren. It is necessary for us to wake up, for us not to think that we have something or someone else has something. No one, the Word of God cries out, is worth speaking about. No man is worth speaking about. We are all unprofitable, wretched people. And even the Word of God informs us, if we do all that is written and all the will of our Lord, then again we will say that we are useless servants because we did what we owed to do. It is a complete necessity for us to take off every form of authority, usefulness, abilities, and to put on Jesus Christ. Put on the mind of Christ, to let Christ reign in our hearts and for Him to work in there. Not with our thoughts. That's why, what does Jesus Christ say? When they call you to confess, don't think what you will say or do, but deliver yourselves to God and let the Holy Spirit speak, because then it will not be you speaking, but the Holy Spirit of truth will be. Let's take off, my brethren, every thought of power, of abilities, let's say, that we can't do a thing, but only Christ can do everything. Amen, brethren. It is such a great need. And I point this out in these later days. Only if we walk with the guidance of the Holy Spirit, we will have the ability simply to survive. And we'll let Christ do His work as He wishes. In the danger of me becoming tiresome, I will repeat it. We must take off, rebuke, condemn, convict every thought of ours about ourselves and every thought about any other person in this church. We must confess that no one here is worth talking about. No one here. Don't be amazed by your husband. Don't be amazed of your wife. Do not be amazed of your children. Don't be amazed of your parents. Don't be amazed of the elders. Don't be amazed of the pastor. Do not be amazed of any man. We are all alike, unworthy, vile, wretched. That's what we are. The only one who's worthy of amazement is Jesus Christ the Lord. The only thing that's worth obeying is the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Word of God, which is alive and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit and of joints and marrow. And all are naked before Him, open to His eyes. Only glory to Christ. Only our thoughts and our respect to Christ. Only obedience to Christ. If you want to look around as a servant. Nothing else. Not for others to serve you. Don't look at them as servants. They are. But the servants of Christ, not yours. You are a servant of your brethren. So you can find grace by God, and God might make you His servant. Amen, brethren. Otherwise, just the two of them returning back. They were conversing about all those things that happened. Disappointed, sad. See what happened. He's out the door also. We've got no one to hope in anymore, because they saw towards Jesus Christ the man, but did not see that in Him dwelt all the fulfillment of Godhead. Hallelujah. All the fulfillment of Godhead. They did not see the Word of God, which was He, but they saw Jesus of Nazareth. They would take up his swords and knives, and he would stir everyone up in a revolution against the Romans. And when they saw him on the cross of Calvary, instead of giving glory to God for this sacrifice, they were disappointed. They were disappointed from the great victory in heaven, from the triumph of the kingdom of heaven, where all the angels were praising and all of heaven was glorifying God. They said, no, we're lost. How foolish and slow of heart to believe in all that is written in the Word of God. But Jesus Christ loves them. That's why he visited them. And because he does love us, that's why he visits us and tells us these things. It's the love of Christ who's saying these things to us. Why are you sad? What are you talking about? Sadly? Like Elisha's servant. Can't you see, Lord? The Syrian's army. We had so many things to tell him. Can't you see, Lord? Why we're sad? Why we're depressed? Why we're disappointed? We prayed, we asked, we believed, we hoped, but now nothing. Can't you see, Lord? And the word of this man was very, very serious. Oh, foolish ones, and I believe that you and I are also in this word. Oh, foolish ones and slow of heart to believe in all that the prophets have spoken, all that are written in the word of God, and what we will eat in the seventh and eighth year if we don't sow and reap. Oh, foolish ones and slow of heart to believe in all the promises of God. Triple portion of blessings I will give you if you just believe. And if you believe and obey and do not sow and reap and do not prune, am I not able to give you triple portion of blessings even beforehand so I can help you believe? And now that I think about it, God is giving us much blessings until now to all of us so we can believe that for the rest of the years, the rest of the year, I don't know how long it is, it might be days or months, I don't know. But what I do know is that God will be with us. He who started the good work will finish it. He who started to bless will multiply his blessings to us. But you and I must walk by faith on the water. Because waves will come up against us. Left and right, they will surround us. The enemy doesn't want us to pass across the other side. But Christ is able to rebuke the waves and is able to give us the authority to walk upon the waves. Do you believe this? Do you believe this? Hallelujah. Lord, help me believe it. Help me my unbelief. Help me believe it as you want me to. And he started to walk with them and preach to them the word of God. Moses, the prophets, Psalms, all that spoke about Jesus Christ. And you know, my beloved brethren, what a great miracle this is, and grace from God that every day the word of God is preached to us. Every day we hear his word, and his word is rich. And through the radio station and through the church, and personally to each one of us who reads the gospel of Jesus Christ. Of course, whoever doesn't read the gospel of Jesus Christ, Christ doesn't speak to him. Whoever doesn't come to church, God doesn't speak to him. But the word is being preached. It's a river. There it is. Go and drink from it. You will quench your thirst. And the water runs swiftly. It's not a waterfall. And there's a field, beautiful field. Go and find rest. And eat. Go. Satisfy your hunger, but man doesn't go. My beloved brethren, let's start reading more and more the gospel. Let's start coming more constantly to church. Let's start being more diligent. Diligent in the will of God. It's not good for the church to be full only on Sundays and on Monday to be half empty. Why? Don't you know that the glory of God depends on your diligence and God's blessings? How can God bless you? How can you claim His blessings when you don't do what He tells you to do, when you don't do it as He tells you to do it? God is good, yes, and He always answers. But let's claim walking by faith in the obedience of the gospel that remained every day in the apostles' doctrine, every Sunday breaking bread, in prayers, and in fellowship with the others. They remain in these things. Lately, I see that we are very late in coming to church. Why, brother, do we not fear God anymore? Church starts at 10 in the morning, and we come at 11:15. Why? Why? Don't you feel sorry for yourself? Don't you fear that God's looking at you? I can't understand this. I can't understand it. And last night I was crying. God put tears in my eyes for this. The Lord is coming. God wants to bless us. God wants to glorify His name. What are we doing? What are you doing? Are you playing? Are you laughing, joking? Whoever works the work of God neglectfully, he will be cursed, the Bible says. Why? Are there many important reasons for this? More important than obeying the gospel? Are there many important things in your life now? Why? Why? It's as if God is saying this to us now. Truly, I'm telling you, I'm not saying it because I'm saying it firstly to me. Why? Why be neglectful? Why be lukewarm? Don't you know that Christ is about to vomit out those who are lukewarm? Why? What is this that God wants to give you and He won't? That you want God to give you and He won't? And much, much more than what you need, God will do. And a triple portion of the Holy Spirit, if it's needed, He will offer it to you. Why? My brethren, brother, sister, Christ is asking you, and me also, why? What is the reason? What is this great reason that we are leaving the will of God and we go to do other wills? What's the reason? Why are you turning back? He says to those two who are going to Emmaus, look at the word of God says. And you know, my beloved brethren, when Christ was revealed to them because their eyes were closed and they could not see Him, and we who are in here, we have our eyes closed and we don't see Jesus, but we do hear His word. And once He was revealed to them, He vanished. And in that moment, in that night, they returned back. And they found the rest of them saying, is Christ risen or not? Christ Himself went and brought those two back, those two who were going to Emmaus. The excuse, I'm tired, is not an excuse, it's a lie. I'm saying this for myself, it's a lie. It's a lie that comes from our hearts. You're not tired, you think you are. You're excusing yourself. You're lying. When you come here, Christ will give you rest. When you come here, Christ will speak to you, bless you. And He will open the floodgates of heaven for you. Don't let our hearts fool us, my brethren. Let's believe in the Word of God. Let's believe in the Gospel of Jesus Christ. And when they returned, among them, Christ. They were frightened. It's a spirit. It's not a spirit. Look at my hands. Look at my side. Look at my feet. Touch me. Handle me. and see, for a spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have. But I have flesh and bones. Give me food, and I will eat. And he ate with them, with his new body. They looked at him, observed him, amazed, astonished. They marveled, they glorified, their hearts were flooded with joy. And then he opened, their understanding, that they might see and comprehend the scriptures. Here it is, my beloved brethren, to whom God reveals his gospel to. God doesn't show partiality. God doesn't show partiality at all. And understanding and the revelation of the gospel isn't. So we can boast. It is so God can give us the ability to multiply his blessing in our lives. Glory to God. And when he revealed the gospel to them, the scriptures, then he said to them, now remain in Jerusalem. That's a commandment. Remain in the church, remain in Jerusalem. That's where your home is. That's where you must dwell in. Can you say that? That the church is my home? Can you say this, brother? Is it your home? Why shouldn't it be? Why? Why shouldn't the church be your home and for you to enjoy and obtain all the promises that God has written to him who dwells under the shadow of the Almighty God and walks in his mercy and grace? Why? The way we're going, we'll be coming at the end of the service. It's better for us not to come at all. It's like those who receive the Spirit that you had not known the Word of God than to know it and abandon it. The commandment of Christ towards the church is be zealous. Become zealous. Because you will see those who are zealots increase and enter richly through the gates into the kingdom of heaven. And whoever doesn't decide today, my brethren, beloved, to become zealous with all his heart, obedient to the will of God, he will regret it. But it will be too late then. May God give us his grace and mercy to all of us. To all of us. Let's let Christ, my brethren, govern our lives. You cannot govern your life. You cannot govern the church. And we must understand that no one holds the steering wheel in the church to lead people. Governor in the church is Jesus. But I plead with you in the name of Jesus Christ. Let's all repent. Let's all repent sincerely, truly, not in words only, but in actions. Let's go to prayer and say, Lord, forgive us. Let's ask, my beloved brethren, peace with all people and holiness, to become zealous in spiritual things, to walk in the most excellent way, which is love, to ask for the major gifts, not so we can show off, so our church can look great, but so we can enter richly into the kingdom of heaven. To forget all that we have done until now. To condemn them and convict them in the name of Jesus. Their transgressions, iniquities. The way is dangerous. And let's start from the gospel of Jesus Christ. From being filled with the Holy Spirit. And us serving the church. I want to say something that's harsh, but it's the truth. You will not enter the kingdom of heaven the way you're going. That's what God is saying. He cannot rapture you the way you are. you must be full of the Holy Spirit and fire. Because Christ baptizes in the Holy Spirit and fire. The trumpet will be heard, and you will not be able to be filled with the Holy Spirit, since now you cannot be filled. The trumpet will be heard, and you will not be ready, since now you're not ready. Don't let our hearts fool us anymore, that we are tired, that we've got other things to do, most important. The most important job for us to do is for us to take part in the rapture of the church. And if you win all the world, and you lose your soul, what have you gained? What will it profit you? What will it profit you? My brethren, I don't want to see people coming late to church. Not I. God. He doesn't want this. For you to come half an hour earlier, isn't it better? You will win so much to the kingdom of heaven. Let's become zealous. Amen, brethren. Amen. Whoever wants to become zealous, put his hand up before the Lord. Lift both your hands up. Hallelujah. Let's become zealous, my brethren, in spiritual things so we can enter richly into the kingdom of heaven. Why should we lose a chance? It's as if, as I once said to my son Dino, read, study, a few days are left. Why should you lose a chance to enter university? And he went and studied. That's what Christ is saying to us now. Study, my child, work, become zealous. Why should you lose the chance of the rapture of the church? Why? Why? Don't you feel sorry for yourself, your family? Do you not fear God? Why? Amen.